when it was Kemet, Black Egypt. It was a Nile Valley civil, Black Egypt. Like and subscribe, Black Egypt. It wasn't no Mediterranean culture, like and subscribe. You gon' get tormented for 4 minutes if it's war when it just said Jesseru got a false door in it. The Nubian flow, that's before Kemet. My Sakim T got rubies and gold, and it's fit for a Kushite king. But what it look like, the green Sahara ring bearer bring terror to your satellite kingdom, so they do not bother me. Scarification look like wavy line pottery. Kush with the black top pots, a rap top notch, and I could kick you till your laptop stops. I'm like Tahaka, Shabaka, or Pianchi, the author's a father. Any cocky, I came down to now through the lands of Kush, living a pre-dynastic pharaoh way in Marrow way. Kerma, Khartoum, or Semna by the fifth cataract. Now I put the fifth wheel on the Cadillac. So much ride, a white man couldn't battle that though, they had to paddle back. Black Egypt. Black Egypt. Black Egypt.
Gotta look and see where the Nile started.
Black Egypt.
How it was easier to go down than upstream. And watch where the river flow. Don't look at the color, look at the culture.
Black Egypt.
I see
what you know about Dynasty 00. Roll through with Shimsu, Hey Room on the standard. Ta-Nehisi, Sudanese G's. Try to test me. I'm an archer from Ta Seti. The squad ready, so I'm stepping in with the extra thin leopard skin. A tail on the apron with my crown on. You can crack jokes, but I ain't the one to clown on. Ayo, Egypt was black, and that's a fact. All you little suckers need to step on back. They tried to throw us off, but we kept on track. We started doing research, what you slept on that. And with Kemet, it don't matter what the name mean. If it's a black culture, then that's the same thing. Race science is a lame thing. Ever since Nubian times, I let the chain swing. How the first known of Egypt was Ta Seti, but Ta Seti was Ta Seti already. Yep, it meant the land of the bow, and when Egyptians needed archers, this is where they would go to recruit them. I got arrows and I'll shoot them. Who them fake pharaohs? I uproot them and usurp them. Black Egypt. 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 Black Egypt.
What's up? What's up?
About the beach, come on. Got that white crown.
Let's get a good build going on. Let's go.
Babylonian bars, you can really spit it, get it, dagger on me. That harpoon, it ain't for abalone. Phoenician pieces made of Nubian gold. Antediluvian scrolls hit the Nubian poles. And if you wanna debate that, you'll get truly exposed. I'm like the king of Axum, Axon. Bring the Maxims of Ptah back to action. I actually swing my axe, so Y-axis, 32 degrees west on the Y-axis. Try and catch us, Christianity was stolen from Kemet, lying bastards. Compare the Book of Psalms to Amenope. Sometimes I'm rhyming, I'm just like a shaman, okay? I rock the white crown, Tashima. You rock the red crown, Tameho. You rock the white crown, Tashima. You rock the red crown, Tameho. I'm a star charting Bantu boy with my bow and arrow. I raise a king in my gnome if I don't know the pharaoh. Explosive and lethal in your dreams like Joseph the Hebrew. And no sending evil, why jet and neck bent? Here to ward that off, I'm not a sage burner. Scroll learner, the page turner, okay. The script writer, put the pen down, cause I don't fucking need it. Cause I got the white crown of Upper
I rock
Egypt.
The white crown, Tashimbo. You rock the red crown, Tameho. You rock the white crown, Tashimbo. You rock the red crown,
I'm a C group, Magi Archer, from Ta-Nehisi. You conscious community pseudos never try to test me. It's Amin Ra squad up, fuck religion. And when I'm on the mic, don't cut my wisdom, boy. I'm W.E.B. Du Bois. I'll smother you under the Sphinx heat, Du Bois. ancestrally cooking up mean lyrics. Cats fighting cause they don't think the Dogon has seen Cirrus. And DNA can't prove ethnicity. How you conscious? You say Pacific instead of specifically. You know my shit so raw, you get crushed. Think the force of a hippo jaw. It's the magic.
Top
shimbo,
you rock the red crown. Top mecho, you rock the white crown. Say top shimbo, you rock the red crown. Say top mecho, I rock the white crown. Say top shimbo, you rock the red crown. Say top mecho, you rock the white crown. Say top shimbo, you rock the red crown. Say top mecho.
How y'all doing today? Can't wait to drop that banger. Hope the video come out cool. Shout out to Dead Perry on the track.
Well, I ain't got no beats just sitting here. Last time I tried to just play some beats in the background. My computer was active. I mean, my computer acted funny because I had my beat machine on. I don't know what's up with that. How y'all doing this today? What's up? I'm just looking to see what I got over here. And I was just doing my standard everyday research. Going through the word of bush, looking up terms. And right here, as we're starting to use the translators, translators and memory is the only way thing that's helping me learn some German. Like, I ain't really trying to learn that. I'm gonna learn what I need to learn in order to, you know, go through certain texts. But just going through entries like this, I'm just slapping them in translators. That's because this is a dictionary. So when we talk about the Murm Patash Stele, Murm Patash Stele, whatever, it is a Stella basalt slab that was originally for Amenhotep III, I believe. I guess Pharaoh Merenptah found it and wanted to use the backside of it for his inscription. So this is where they, again, we know this is supposedly where we find the first mention of Israel. So I just been looking over it and going over a few things, looking at the text, looking at the grammar, and tripping. I can make this bigger for y'all. And so one thing I proposed that I was telling people was that you see these double read leaves here. Notice we've been having a lot of conversation about the double read leaves lately. We're hearing the word vignette, I would say. Hearing the word vignette, it's just, you know, how we pronounce that transliteration. We have the word Winnie with the T feminized, meaning vignette, or stating vignette, and meaning something like baldness, bald head, call heat. And again, the something about a bald head on the, just because I've been looking this up, not because I'm trying to, like, you know, it was something like bald head. I could put it on the screen, I think. Let me see. Oh, yeah. Kalheit der Augenbrauer, or whatever. Baldness of the outer eyebrows.
All right. Whatever. If that's a such thing, he has the attestation supposedly where it should be able to be found. Do me a favor, like the video so we can have it popping. It's early in the stream. We need to get some people in here, have a good show. So one thing I've located this variations of this term. So let's just talk about it. The root of this term here, and without the hair determinative, see, without the hair determinative is not going to be talking about hair anymore in this instance. Unless, of course, they wrote the term to be talking about hair and left the determinative off. When you see the same consistent when up here, but you see the determinative changing behind it. So this says when new. And before trying to read any of the German, when new, and we have a determinative. I don't want to say this is the egg, but it's eluding me from looking here, and we got the three strokes. So what is schold? Anybody know in German? We about to learn. So it's when you owe somebody. Now, I guess this determinative is probably used in something for, I don't know, something used for compensation. But again, we'd have to test his sources and see how they came up with that. But to focus on how this is relevant to the Mer and Patas Stela, this term we see here without the T, or at least this transliteration without the T, which could be a feminizer or not. This term could just be, have a T on it. And without that determinative, it's something like what we find on the Mern Patas Stela. So when that's a different version of it. Let me go back. That's probably it. Maybe this is it. I just want you to pick this so we could get this in and keep on talking about what we was talking about. Now, obviously, I know all the problems I'm going to incur by thinking that this says Syria. I've been doing the research to see if that's a possibility. And where I'm being led so far, it appears to be one. So I guess I need to pull up the version from my document on rapgod.wordpress. Make sure y'all visit rapgod.wordpress. I'm going to be updating some of them articles soon. And the article I'm going to pull this from is called When Shalom Was Only Stated by the Cowering Man, an example why the reasons why E.A. Wallace Budge is not a good source for neophytes. 2012, we went over this a few times, but I love the ability to be able to go back and reference a few of the things that are pointed out in this article, showing how Budge was messing up on some of his transliterations. And he was even one transcribing Top Pedget for Tassetti, and I ain't really mad at that now. Kind of think it might be have some sense to it. But then they changed that on him. It's like, nah, that ain't right, it's Tassetti. But those are some of the questions you ask people. Peace to the chat. I see Sot12, what's up? I see Asar M. Ka in the building. Man himself, Joe, Lil King, C.A. Black Sheep, Sadiq. I can see y'all. Thanks for tapping in. And so if I can find it on here, it's going to make it a lot better. Here we are. This should simplify things because everyone can't really parse the language, right?
And so when we talk about parsing the language, is when you got a script where all the letters run all together, you got to know the system of separating words. And so if you see the term, so-called term or phrase we have in red, again, we know, everyone should know by now, that that's the term that they say is Israel. We could talk about how they came to these conclusions. All right, we got the double reed leaf being used. And we're talking about standard Egyptological. Now, if you grab a pen right now, I mean, I know most people ain't into this, but grab a mental pen. And I mean, I ain't into it that much to actually grab a pen. But if you are, grab a pen, what you're going to see is going to be funny. So, and if not, just mentally take a note of this. This first double reed leaves are being translated by academia as a Y. We all understand this. All right. Here we have the door bolts or what have you being transliterated as a S. So we got YS. Here we have shortened version of the double reed leaves, just not diagonal, but we all know that this is a shortened version of the double reed leaves, which has given us another Y. So we got YSY. Now we got the R here, the open mouth. All right. We got a single reed leaf. Now, when this double reed leaf represents a Y, a single reed leaf will be the placeholder for the I sound. So we got Y, S, Y, R, I. Now here we have an A bird. Some have placed the argument that this might not be an A bird. It's not an M bird though, as we look further. It appears to be an A bird. Or the vulture. When I say A bird, it holds the phonetic quality of the ah sound, maybe a weak A. All right. Most Egyptologists transliterate it as an A. And so R, a backwards three, which holds a soft sound close to an A. And now we have another mouth, just like here. But it is argued that for some strange reason, and I think they're lingering on the logogramic stroke we have here, that this is now a L instead of a R. But they transliterate it as a R and saying it's holding the place of an L. So what they have to say that this says Israel is Yissi-R, you know, Yissi-R. Ir, and you can look that up. Yissi-R-Ir-R. I don't even know how that would be pronounced as a word. How would that be? Yissi-R-Ir-R. I don't know. But we have the E, the Y sound, the S, the Y, the R, the I, the A, and another R, which they're saying trans should be used as an L because this is apparently a loan word. So that's what scholarship got for that. Peace, brother. Garfield in the building, my man's 50 grand. Yo, you ever come out to the West Coast and you in the Bay Area and you don't hear me, I'm lightweight gonna be offended, just to let you know. Especially because you took care of me when I came out New York. So make sure you make your way out to the West Coast in the Bay Area, hit up the Madjai, I'll take you to some of the museums out here. You know what I'm saying? Pure Black, what's up? Pure Black in the building. Okay, so that's a good one. He said he's confused if there are no vowels in Medunet or how do we have sounds for the A and the L. And so instead of trying to, again, it's best to use sources to show people how this works. I think I got one open here. And so let's And so they got what's called weak vowels. You feel me? They got what's called weak vowels, and certain symbols that do represent soft vowels and soft consonants. And, oh, you know what? I got a perfect website up that'll illustrate this right now. If not, it should be saved in my thing right here. Hold up. I'm going to show you. And I'm going to share this link for people. Here we go. Wow. All right, so notice here that even though we don't got all the vowels, now this is the transliteration of the hieroglyphics lexicon, basically some of the sound symbols. So first of all, it's not in your ABC order because we wasn't rocking like that. They don't wanna do it like that. They call that. I don't even wanna name the term because certain pseudos been using the term acting like it mean more than it mean. But anyway, all right. You see, we have an A here, an I here, and another A here. We know those as vowels. But those are the only ones we have here, and that the way that they act inside of this language is almost like a weak vowel or a weak vowel. Or, you know, so let's go in on that and see how this is described, because this site is basically breaking down everything. So remember when I was saying the vulture bird was an A? And they're seeming to show us this. And so they're giving us, now we could just go through various uses of the word where it's actually used to represent an A sound. I don't know if they got it in this rendition of Abydos, right? They don't. But again, it is like, see how we say Abydos? We don't just say Budos. And so whatever we saying at our Abu, when we say Abu, it's really just boo spelled here, but again, if you see it spelled out, I guess in some form it must have. Let's look at how the word of bus got all the abus. I don't want to get distracted. Basically, what I'm trying to explain is there are some weak vowels in the ancient Egyptian language, just not all of them. And so actually the ones that were in question, the I and the A, you actually can find them here. And then when I click on them, they're going to represent what I was saying they should be represented on the Stela. Remember we was talking about the vulture bird. I said it was an A. If we go back here, we see this rendition of it here representing AA. Now we said a single reed leaf was an I. And so this is why tools like this is very good to use, because if I click on the I could simply show you that single reed leaf is an I. All right, now you can find it again in terms that use the single reed leaf. And again, it should be preceding the majority of these terms. So now if we look at this term, it got an I and an A at the beginning of it. Two things that represent vowels, soft vowels. And so probably the word was probably, they're in conjecture that it was probably like, I wet. You know what I'm saying? And I'm just putting that forth. But transliteration is really not there for us. Unless we have the vowels, it's really not there for us to try to pronounce it. It's kind of like there for what we're doing now. Matching up these texts to then take it to see what that means. So now that we got this I and this A corroborated, I can also show y'all everything. The double reed leaves, obviously, as we know, we go click Y over here. Well, see, they got the Y right here. And you're going to see double reed leaves. So here is a different rendition of double reed leaves. Anyone can, so this is what's going to happen. These is what you'll learn. Never begin words. Now, if they want to use double reed leaves at the front, they're never going to put two diagonal strokes. See, well, here we got two strokes right here that represent what we see here. but they didn't put them diagonal, we still know it's a Y. But notice how if I go to any of these words, and I haven't done this before, it's just my knowledge of the language, what we'll learn is they're not going to be able to show us this at the beginning of these terms. It's going to turn to double reed leaves. In most instances, I could be molding myself live, but normally it don't turn out that way. Because, see, they ain't going to be able to put two small slants at the beginning of an ancient Egyptian word. So this is what our knowledge tells us of the language and not, you know what I'm saying, anything else. Any of these attestations I click in, I'm willing to put Vegas money that any of these words won't have an attestation, even though we know that this Y is represented by two diagonal strokes. Each of these representations are going to have two reed leaves just like this. How do we know this? Because we look over text all day. And so you get a heightened knowledge of how this stuff was used. Click right here. If they starting it with these two strokes, no, they not. I was scared they was about to though. But they're not, because we know we know. And they're not going to start this one with those strokes either, see? So now they got one single stroke and two double strokes. So they're saying this person's name is, first they got it translated as Hay. Now this is being left out of here if you notice. This just means a man. They're transliterating his name from this. Oh, excuse me, let me go back. And so I'm going to share this link too, because, you know, we try to do the opposite. But I'm going to start sharing all everything. Make sure I share things twice for my members of the page. Shout out for the people who joined the page. I appreciate y'all. So I'm trying to start at this double reed leaf, this other version of an H that we should all know if we start. This little box that's separated in the middle is also an H. And then we got the double Y again. So look up here. If I can make it smaller, it say YHY. Now they're saying hey. This is basically how you saying hey. This was the expression hey. So it's a man saying hey. But I don't want to get distracted. We're showing, so now we learned that, okay, even though we see two strokes slanted, and now if you look in further on this, if I open up Gardner, what you're going to learn is these two strokes don't have to be slanted. And so we learned that from reading text too. You see, here go the two small strokes, but they didn't make them slanted. So now we know this is why, because we just went over the big reed leaf and seen all of the instances where words beginning had a Y. We know S, Y, R, I, A, and then an R again, right? See, that don't make sense. So this is what I showed us. When I went to the word of bush earlier, remember, and this is my search. You see this term? You see that? Just remember this bunny and some water under it. It always means existence. And now it'll change with the determinative. But in this instance right here, if like in this word, it means your hair don't exist on your face. So it's baldness. So it still kind of got to do with existence. But we got when knee, because you know this is the Y now, remember? Every time you see the two reed leaves, don't trip. Now you got the T. So it's like when yet, because we putting the E in between, but since we don't know what the vowels was. So this ain't a real pronunciation, it's just for scholastic purposes. Now what I want you to see is double reed leaves following the bunny and the N. Everybody can see this. This is why I love doing it this way. You see two reed leaves following the bunny and the N, so you can see it. Right here, too, you see the bunny in the end, but you see two reed leaves right here. So this helps form my argument that these words are parsed incorrectly. Now, the strong suit, welcome to the Magi, and thanks to everybody who's trying to support and make this channel grow. I just watched a video got put up yesterday, got 54,000 views. And the brother on the video sitting there teaching all kind of craziness. I don't even want to trip off that, but we got bigger fish to fry. So we're going to step out on this platform and make sure that our people getting the right information. Those who are concerned. So look. I want to illustrate this. You see that bunny? Everybody see it with my mouse moving. Now it's an N, Now, that's a word. I can't lie. That's a commonly used word. And the word that I'm conjecting to here is a rarely used word. But let's be clear what we're looking at. We're supposedly looking at the first time Israel was mentioned. So less rare than the word I'm conjecting would be the word scholars conject. You see? Winnie is in dictionaries in multiple forms, and that's what I'm spelling over here. So let's discuss that too. See, in transliteration, this is holding the place of a W. I keep talking about how when you say W, you have to realize what you're saying. You're saying two U's, double U. Even when you write a W, you write two U's, but some of us don't notice it. We connect them and we think it's a W. It is a W, but the difference between the sound a W make and a U make is so similar that obviously, try it. I mean, say Mountain Dew with a W and say Mountain Dew with an EW. I mean, say Mountain Dew with a U and say Mountain Dew with an EW, and you tell me the difference. And so really, what I'm pointing out here is when we transliterate when and make this a W and put an E in the middle and then an N and then make this a Y, we say Winnie, but it wouldn't be wrong to say Uni also. So I just wanted to just talk about that before we start going in on it. So now, going back to the dictionary over here, we know it ain't talking about baldness, but if you use, this is an old dictionary, this is the word of Bush. And when we use updated materials, and if I could get one open, this is basically going from like, I think Faulkner and Gardner was alive during the same period, but Faulkner's dictionary was finished later. And a lot of the entries from the website that I'm pulling up is just a digitized version of Faulkner as well as this dictionary. But notice here, when we go in here, what's this? Junior Tigers Run. Oh, this is from when I was just putting my defense on the game. Delete that. So notice here, WN, I'm gonna put WN, I guess I should put a Y, and I'm gonna let it take us here, right? So y'all can see what we're illustrating about the Stella and the parsing, and a few of the things that we're working to bring forth about this. What's up with Dash Arab? What's up with Nebraska? Joe, Immortal. Thanks for stepping in the building. Now, here goes something that's very interesting. And I still got to get a word of Bush more credit. I just started streaming in the middle of some research I was doing, because sometimes I'll be like, why you ain't streaming this? Now, notice this. This dictionary references the word of Bush entry. But as it appears, it does not reference this entry, which has, you see what I'm saying? All of the elements for these being gods or divine beings, I'll say divine beings. You want to know why they're not gods? I'll tell you this, I could beat this all the way up. Because this word, the root of this word, means to exist. You see? So I'm not saying the gods don't exist or the gods don't exist, but when you use this term, it is meant as existence. So this is how they're getting beings out of it, but let me show you why they're putting gods in parentheses, because we got Netru here. So if you want to know how to Netru, look, here go the tongues vibrating on the, see, this is the plurality right here, is what I mean. If you just got this sign, it's only in the chair, only one deity. If you got the three strokes, now it's Netru. So they didn't say that here. They said when it, or they said when in, and we worked out that when already. We talked about that. So I'm doing when in newt, or whatever. How would you say that? When in you. You know, when in they you, whatever. That's not what we're here for, pronunciation, because we looking at the glyphs. And so the real thing is, what has been manifested is this. when nuked, and I need to pull this up further, can be used to say beings. The Nater, the God, is in parentheses because of this. You see? And now it's, you can go further the length to see there are other renditions of this term too. But I just want to show that. And this is what I beseech the attestation for this. Because I can't go off a dictionary entry like a lot of people do. You got to be able to go look at the glyphs, the arrangement, and see what's going to help you. But for the examination of this study, everybody watching who don't know how to need to know how to read glyphs, see a bunny rabbit, some water, are these rigid strokes, and two reed leaves. So now when we go back to a facsimile of the primary account, you see, but don't worry about the color-coded parsing. I did that for my presentation. Oh, I thought I had reparsed it. Dang, yep. I reparsed it for us one day, and that picture should be saved in my documents someplace. So I'm going to try to pull up the reparsing. It should be in this Kimmet somewhere. Screenshot. All right, yeah, it's going to be in here somewhere. And so what we did one day was when we sat up and we was working on this, we basically color-coded how we proposed this should be parsed. And I'm just going to try to find it. I can sit and talk about every picture in here for an hour. All right, and it's not a lot in here. But let's see. I'll go to this folder. Real quick, I want to find this because even though it might take a little time to find it, it's going to make everything a lot more easier to see. So where do my, when I make a screenshot or something, where is it stored? It ain't popping up just like my normal screenshot. Let me go back to this. I never got to whip this one out and talk about this one. These red and black Nubians, but we'll keep it going. And this is Pharaoh Nahesi, but we're going to keep moving. We didn't come to talk about it. If I can't find the parson, then so be it. I'll ask you just to bear with me. Sorry, but every image from every presentation is popping up, and that ain't popping up. Probably have to do it again. Maybe it's just in pictures. All right, well, forget it. Let's get back to it. Nubia? Screenshots. All right, forget it. I'll do it again. So what we're showing here, everybody get it, that these two reed leaves should be included in my parsing. And again, I have a lot of work to do to corroborate this, but look at what this does. Since we understand and we can talk about the reading of this, we went over it last night. If these two reed leaves are attached to this term, and don't forget this, this is just negation for the term. So this could be like an N. So I could say knee Winnie. If these reed leaves are attached to this term to mean these beings don't exist, who are the beings? See, this make perfect sense. Dang, I gotta snap out and come on the camera real quick. This is the problem. I don't sit around and talk about the glyphs all day. I'm not going to do my ABCs. Have you ever seen me do the ABCs? People get on here and be like, they go A, they go B, C, D, E, F, G, and actually will say it and act like they sound like a master teacher or something. I'm only saying this to say, if you use the tools that we are using, you're going to see that what I'm saying is not far-fetched. because you got enough data, enough information, enough qualified sources to show you what I'm trying to show you. For instance, if I was saying that this was a word, this bunny rabbit, this N, and these two reed leaves, and I couldn't just go show you it in the dictionary by going there, or, you know what I'm saying, and showing you it in multiple places, then you could be just saying, I'm just talking my own rhetoric. People don't notice when people doing that. And so we got to further go in on this term. When in we. So we take it out of the dictionaries, obviously, every time we do this, and we go to the, we look for it in the primary text. All right. So notice that this is to, this should be to those who study ancient Egyptian texts, what the blue letter Bible is to those who study the Hebrew. You feel me? If you don't be in the TLA, then you just be in dictionaries. It ain't like, this ain't no cliquish or cultist. This is a standard tool. You watch any Egyptological video that they in talking, that if they up to date now and they look, do philological surveys, they're mentioning the TLA, period. So let me see. So not beans, but I'm gonna go WNN, and then I'll put the dot, was it TU? I don't remember, let me look. Oh, it's NY, it's YNW. I think I need to treat my wife to something today. Make sure y'all keep that stuff popping in y'all life. See? Bow. I'ma beat y'all. I'ma beat them up. Hey y'all. We gonna have hella fun with the primaries. Look, man. I told you. So what's different here? Another N. Everybody know you can leave that out because this is just phonetic complementary. This is why they got when new. Those who exist. So now in the Wörterbuch 130, I could pull it up right here, or I could try to go back to the Wörterbuch where I was. And since they said it was, so I need to refresh this because this page ain't showing right no more for the people. Actually, we're going to take it to the big camera so everybody could be tuned right in and following along. So what this page doing that's malfunctioning? I'm going to have to come back to it. Hold on. Because for some reason, this view is good. Oh, something happened. I must have minimized my screen to the point of ridiculousness. So I was investigating Winnie. Now, let me share this. Because I hate feeling like, you know what? I want y'all to have the tools to not be no pseudos. Nothing. It ain't nobody ever beat me with a tool, yo. Like, that's like the people who didn't want to let a person make a beat on their beat machine. I was like, go ahead. I'll go right upstairs. Come downstairs with no slap. Like, why you ain't slapping? You using all my tools? I'm not talking about this. I'm just saying with the beat machine. So I never had a fear of nobody grabbing at the mic that I'm rocking on, and then that's going to make them rap as good as me. So feel free. And all of us in the community, we have different ways of disseminating our tools, but that's a very good research, a very good one. Shout out to Asar M. Kai, who say we broke the internet. So now let's look at how we do this right here, right? We gonna go tap in with my dude over here who got, he gonna tag me to the quick Wörterbuch again. Now it's good on the screen. So we was getting to that attestation that it means beans. Before we have to finish, because you can't just be talking and showing, you got to show people, yo. Not your little PowerPoint fraud. So what is PowerPoint fraud? It's rampant in the community. Look, you want to be a pseudo, put all kind of pictures on the screen, on slides. Don't put no sources up there, just put hella pictures on the screen, right? In a PowerPoint, and make them, you know, you got to squeeze as many you can onto one slide too, right? And then when you talk about it, show shit that ain't related, but just keep showing how it look related on your slides. skip to the next slide, never show no sources, and act like you're giving a well-qualified presentation. Dude, that's PowerPoint fraud. And there's cats out here pulling that off in the community right now. They just put anything on, like, I'm gonna put together a PowerPoint fraud presentation for y'all. I'm just gonna put all kind of shit on the screen and talk for an hour. And at the end, I'm gonna show y'all, look, bro, this was complete bullshit. And we let people do that all day. So if while I'm ranting and rambling, if you want to understand what I'm doing, looking through the word of bush for the attestation with the two read leaves. See, I know this one means to shine. I don't gotta even translate to German because we gonna have the sun back here. So when I find the one with the two read leaves that match the attestation that we're getting from the other dictionary, then we're gonna be on to something. But here we are here, see? Now we're gonna start beating them up. Look, who is this? Now we gotta whip out the translator. I'm gonna tell you because I see a man standing on this noose. Not a noose like that, but I don't really, and he got the cane and he ain't pluralized, but he got the T at the end. Yep, he's somebody who won something, but it's a person. Look, triumphator. I don't even need to really translate that, but I will to be thorough. So what are we finding here? This is research I'm gonna cite this, I'm gonna take this, I'm gonna go find a real primary attestation for it, right? Now we got some bull, calf, also baked Des Osiris. So this is something like a calf whinny or whatever. Now it could be written this way. But again, I ain't trying to stop, yo. Look through everything forever and be knowing what you're talking about. So I'm gonna keep going. And I hope everybody's following what we're doing. We lightweight looking through the word of bush to see if this term that we are proposing in a new parsing of the Israel or the Mara Patah Stella that would cause the following word to be Syria. We can talk enough about the history of Syria didn't exist then. No, that's not true. And I got plenty of documents that show. All right, here we got another one. And this appears to be some type of snake. And if I translate it, it's going to be speaking to, it should be speaking towards the existence of that snake or something. Let me see. Like it. All right, so right here. I'll make it a little smaller. And so if we go to Begder, we about to do that real quick, just for the fun of it. I gotta make this smaller. Make it fit on top. So what is this? Begder, what did I say? URAUSSCHLANG. Solange. The primordial snake. At the primordial snake. So why I see that's probably why he get primordial out there. Because of the word exist being at the root? I don't know. Who knows? But okay, at the primordial snake. And hopefully D20, if we look through his notes, would take us to some place to see where that was attested. Anyway, I don't want to keep on this part for too long. I think we made the point that the term is a term. We see a rat, we see the bunny, we see the water, and we see two reed leaves. And next it would be to find the attestations of the term, and this is when the TLA comes in good. Now here we have an entry, but we don't know if we have an attestation. Normally, when you get green on the TLA, you're going to have an attestation, but you could be just getting lucky. So there are five, see? Now we getting somewhere. So it was five times this was used to say those who exist. Therefore, it makes perfect sense, y'all. It makes too much dang sense because this means to cause them not to exist. It says, Uri, so I wish I had another point of reference to help this out. Maybe I'm going to open up a Zoom because when I'm the only person saying it, you might just think that I'm just saying it. If another person read this, you would see exactly what I'm talking about. Or whatever. And you ain't got to feel free, anybody who wants to join in. Invite. Right. Yeah, my email, you can hit casual@hieroglyphics.com. Let me see. They go to Zoom. Shit. They go to Zoom. All right, so if anybody want to tap in, feel free. We're going to keep it going. Those who exist, you see, now, am I on the pseudo bench for taking this Y? Why Israel got a Y at the beginning anyway when they know how to put an I? Who said Israel was ever called Yish-Yir-E-R? Yish-Yir-E-I-R. Who said that? Now, everybody see the bunny, the water, and the two reed leaves. We just went over that. So what I want to reiterate is my parsing includes these two reed leaves in this word that we see means to exist. If we have to go over attestations to see how it was actually used, they give us five. And the first one is going to go back to, who is this? I got to translate it to English. And it's not translating this to English because this is German and I got it on French. So let me take it off French and go to German. Hold on. Page is not in French. Thank you. Let me just put detect language, bro. That way it make it easier. Wow. There you go. And so this is going to give us what time period? 1920 of dynasty. Perfect. Perfect. You see how this works? It is in the lexicon. It is in the grammar of the Egyptians on the Stela. God, you can't make this up. I mean, you could go too far, but you can't make this up, though. Why is it going back to French again? This page ain't French, man. Beware of the burdensome that is of being too great and abundant or inundated. And too great and inundation, so that beings are small. Beings here, people here, is used with the double reed leaf. Now, this is just the TLA. So how you find the primary of this before you get the bump in your gums? Because I don't hop out the window. Now I got some old French books to buy. I either got to buy this one, which is going to be the best one, or I can see which one I can find online. Literary Ostraca, because these books are going to have the primary in it. It's the closest you could get. And so if they don't have a museum on here, we're going to show all of this. But here's is the bibliography we're looking at first. I normally go for this one because they normally put their strongest source up top. I know how to get this book, and I think I'm in the club already. You have to join a French society to buy some D-F-I-F-A-O books. And that's how I bought all of the facsimiles from them. I only joined that society to buy the books. I never did no meetings or nothing. But here we go. With some remarks on new words, boss. So let's see if we can cite and pull up this primary. Fisher, now we got some him. Proceedings in the 22nd Congress of the Orientalists held in Istanbul. So you see how the majority of this stuff is written not in English? Him malakru de nil Egyptian. I don't even know what language that is, so I don't know if I'm doing the right accent. Jay Foster hymns, prayers, and songs, and anthropology of Egypt, lyrics, and poetry. This is probably one that I could probably find it in on page. Look nice in English. But it's going to be the less, it ain't going to have a primary account. So now, where is it? It's a type of object. It was a stone shard, a lime ostracon. Do they going to say where it's housed? So on a lot of them, they would tell you where it is housed. So I'm going to go after this real quick. Now I'm just doing me. Let me see. It's how much stuff you're going to be able to talk about. Oh, you feel me? Right online. So that's even better. That's not that society that we were talking about. Now they said, Paige, what? Because what are we looking here for? We need to know what wall they scraped this up off of. We can't just be, how did I get to the him to the now? Hold on, let me go back. Oh, Nile Hemis? Oh, okay, this is a familiar text then. Oh, that's even more checkmatey. I ain't even got to do all of that. Now, it's on the hem to the now, which a lot of us know that's not such an arcane or hard to find text. So, that's cool. Where else is it used? This is the plume scale, the seat of the bull against one who is in the stuff of your tongue, the abyss who is before the creatures or the beings. That is those people. I come in the night entirely to protect your beings. And this is Ptolemaic Roman. Now we're in the Ptolemaic Roman times. So now I'm mounting a new argument that this term wasn't even too much in existence. Look, this first account right here, lining up with the dates of the Mern Ptah stele. Y'all see what's happening? The term we talking about that we conjecting is on the stele right here with the double reed leaves occurs in the same time period. So this, and they already translate this as beings on every translation. So we pretty much could say that that's there. Now, let's move to the second part. Because we already transliterated this in the beginning for people to keep up. It was Y-S-Y-R-I-A. But now let's do it again now that we got this Y attached to the first word. And I'm going to walk y'all through it. So can't nobody trip. If this Y... Dang, I need to find my new parts. And I'm going to just do it again. Hold on. I'm just going to do it again. Everything is better when you just slow down a little bit. So allow me. You feel me? So I'm going to do it again for us. I should just stop right here. Well, not really. Well, I could do the whole line, but it gets too small. And so, as soon as that snip pops up, I'll be able to reparse it. So now, we've seen the old parsing. Now let's look at the new parsing. And why is this the new parsing? Because we be doing the knowledge. We ain't letting nobody menudo us. And we give you enough tools to see that we ain't bumper rumping them. Just bumping our gums. Like cats be doing. Talking all dang day. And not really. See, this is the difference between demonstration, and conversation. Cats who sitting there telling you about it, but not showing you. Now, why did I leave off that end on top? We'll talk about that too. But everybody knows that that is used for negation here. Uh-oh, now what's happening? Now we're starting to see. And everything I do in this color code is qualified by the grammar of ancient Egyptian, what they teach. Now, none of this is, because cat, smash, don't accept it. Nah, this ain't me. This is me showing you how these things are used. So I could go back to yellow for no particular reason. Now, trust me, everything you see here is not necessarily a different word. I'm just color coding for what I need to be talking about, all right? What I'm color coding now are the determinatives that help us determine the classifiers, whatever you want to call them. They help you determine what the term is all about. So now we got it isolated. Now you can see here, and I can blow it up big. It could get a whole lot better. Thank you for participating. Look, now we see here. I already showed us we got this term substantiated. I don't got to talk about that much more. It means the same thing. Beings are existence. You know, a being means existence too. You know that, right? Human being. You can't be a human being if you don't exist, bro. To be is a state of existence. I be chilling. And this is why that's not bad grammar, because some old languages spoke that way, including this one. To say I exist in a state of by saying I be, but they would say Winnie, and that's what we see here. But we see a different version of Winnie in the yellow, the first yellow. So now let's go back to our tools and see what we found here. And I'm not doing it. It ain't no magic. I'm just raw. I'm just playing. It was just a joke. Don't be taken back by that. But I don't know how this fall in my lap and not other people's. You tell me that then. Why is this in my lap? On my desk. Top. Because I'm going to show you. This top bolt right here, we have to qualify with the sources. We're going to click on the S. See? And so, I ain't no magic going on. Hold on, website. Hurry up. Now, the version of an S. Excuse me, this water. Oh, shit. The version of the S you see here is not the same S. This is the door lock S that we're talking about. Let's see if they pull it up. See? Maybe I need more water. This is the door lock S, okay? And so that's the one we see on the text, and we see it even better. We got an S. Don't forget, my parsing is making sense. Remember we learned about these two strokes? Remember what we're spelling out here now. We got an S. We learned that those two strokes were what? And why? We did all of that, so I'm not going to go over it again. So now in the parsing, we have an S and a Y. Everybody should know by now that's been watching this is a mouth and it represents an R. Do I have to show that? Yeah, let's be thorough. Click R. All that's going to pop up is a mouth. Okay? That's an R. These are the different ways it could be used. If it got a logogramic stroke under it, it's really a mouth. So if I find the one on here that say mouth and I click on it, it should have a logogramic stroke under it. All right, but it's used so many words that I'm not going to keep on expounding on everything. Let's just keep making the point. Here we discuss why this is an I and why this is an A. Let's go back and prove that. This is an I, one reed leaf will appear. Okay? And this is an A, even though they're representing soft vowels that we supposedly don't have in the language. They go to vulture. Spell that out loud. Somebody type that in the chat. Come on, man. What did we just spell? So I'm not doing this. I'm not making this up. You tell me what that spells and we'll talk about your contingency with it. Because your contingency with it is going to be that is not how Syria, S-Y-R-I-A. You're going to say that is not how Syria was spelled at 1000 B.C. Maybe 1100, whatever time you want to put it, Mer Ptah. I'm going to tell you you're incorrect. And guess what I'm going to use? Primary sources. I'm about to close down the Zoom because I'm cooking and I don't need it open and nobody came in. Let me see. End meeting for all. Look, primary sources that say Syria for the people of the Anatolian region. So who could do that? I'm not talking about any feat I've achieved. I'm talking about who could show that this don't say Syria. Now I gotta start working out some scholarship. But you don't gotta go that far if you know where to look. See, I'm gonna whip out a map for us to understand. But before nailing this in, we're not done. We parsed, let me take that off. We parsed up the parts that said, oh, no, I don't want to do all that. How do you go put it back? How do you redo? Oh, well, I'll learn. We parsed up the parts that said, I accidentally took off some of the yellow, but it don't matter. We need to keep going because now we have an R, what they call an R here, and they want to switch it from an R to an L to make this. Yes, it don't make no sense. Yisra mean Israel when it just clearly say Winnie Syria. And then has a logogramming stroke under this R that lets us know that it's a word. Now, how many times we gotta pull up the scholars to show that? Every time I make this presentation, I pull up an Egyptological scholar teaching at the Oriental Institute that shows when you have a single stroke, notice none of these glyphs have a single stroke under. You notice that? When you have a single stroke under a glyph, it lets us know to read it logogrammically. So here's the thing. The pseudo, menudo, crudo, they keep telling you, though, this is what they do, though. They'll sit there, I'm just playing. They'll sit there and say, this is a pictographic language. And you're not supposed to read it as sounds. But they can't put up they can't put up any translation reading it the way they say you're supposed to read it. Meaning they cannot make any sense of what we see on the screen. The guy the other day told us this meant that you're supposed to be grounded on a mat, initiated on some type of a mat, and that these people we see here was not initiated. So I respect him for attempting to try to read it. He get more respect from me than Commission, because Commission even scared to be wrong, so he won't even try to read it. He say he don't read symbols. Nevertheless, if we have a system that shows us when to read certain glyphs logogrammically, then we know when to read it as a picture glyph. And this is telling us to do that with this R. So that means the rules that anybody is following to try to make this say Israel are inconsistent with what we know is being taught in Egyptology. And so let me go pull that up, because I don't think everybody's seen every one of my videos. So I gotta go. And trust me, I'm not referencing myself. All right. Now, here we go right here. And it's just a part I always skip to make this point. You know, you could go learn. This video right here is all you really need to watch. Not like that, but it's a 1 hour video, and it's one of the best explanations of the ancient Egyptian language. And it's coming from the Oriental Institute. All right. Now, I'm going to play this again for the people. But you see here, the same exact glyph we're talking about is on his chart. If people understand what words mean, that says logograms. A logo is a word. A gram means to write. So this is a written word. All right? They're not phonograms. Phonograms are phono, a sound. Like you got a phonograph, a record player. So a logogram represents a word. So anybody who be like, no, you gotta know what it mean. Bruh, you gotta know when you gotta know what it mean. Now, I'm gonna let him talk. Single stroke R is what we focusing on. Why are we focusing on that? Because this is wrong. They are translating this as part of this word as just a letter. So now we're gonna put it back here and we're gonna go in to show that this parsing is more correct. This is its own word, and this probably is a phrase. But let's go in on that. And again, we want to hear it from qualified sources. Every time, hear it from the Oriental Institute.
And each word is written using a combination of those signs. So this maybe simplest way to write words in Egyptian is you can use logograms. So you can use this the picture of the item for that item. So for example, upper left, you see an image of a heart, and you can use that. These logograms are often, but not always, used with the stroke. Right. So the stroke underneath it is sort of just to tell you, hey, this is a logogram. So the heart here, and you would read yib, the Egyptian word for heart. Underneath that, the arm, you would just read ah, the Egyptian word for arm, the house sign, pair for house, and etc. So you can just use the sign, the picture of the item to write that word.
So you see, you could just use the picture of the item to write that word. Your brother Asar put what happens to them is after when he says faket, etc. The season is over. He's 100% correct. And so basically what we're explaining here is if this is parsed right, this is the ending of the first statement talking about Yoanam in the beginning, make them to not exist, or Iri Imtim Ni Winnie, make them to not exist. So now they're saying that this next sentence starts with the statement of a people, which I'm showing here, I believe it to be some people. Look, these are people. Now this is gonna be very, all right, it's about to be DoorDash time, y'all. Hold on, my stomach just told me to stop talking and look. But this is about to be very key here, that on this statement, they have people here. Because of what my brother Asar just said in the chat is elemental to the conversation. Because if we scroll over, what they say is, and I got to figure out this mouth stroke, but they're talking about a people here. It says, Faket Ben Peret F. Kor Ru. All right. Now, they don't want to include that Koru either. But since Koru is actually Syria, this is why people can't get away from this. Koru right here, if you see my mouse going in a circle, is actually Syria. So I say Koru Keper Correct. if we read this. Koru, here go the Ru, lion. Okay. Now you got a throw stick and the mountain. Now you got this beetle. Everybody know what a beetle and an R is. Now look at this. This is why the people is pseudo. Every single place I've been pointing to this mouth, I've been telling you is an R. I ain't switched nothing. The only place I'm telling you is not an R, I'm explaining the system. It has a logogrammic stroke under it. Remember, S-Y-R-I-A? So how about this word up here? Sharma. This R is cognate with an L, which makes Shar, S-H-R-L-M, Shalom. How could we do that if this wasn't deciphered and translated? You guys would be able to pick me out. Like he just said, that was an R. So let's continue. Her ret. What's making the ret sound in this word? I said Faket Ben Peret. F. Every time I point to this horny viper, if I don't say F, we're a fraud. If I go see this B right here and I find the instance where, oh no, I need to change it. Bruh, this system is complete and consistent. Now, when you see the this, just look, it's a beetle. It's looking like a broke up tarantula right now. Shout out to whoever about to buy this DoorDash lunch because we cooking. It always happened, and I'll be telling my wife, that'd be hella funny. Be like, man, every day. I appreciate y'all. But I'm going in regardless, but I know somebody gonna hit the Cash App. It's always cool. Like that. I don't need nothing all unhealthy like that, though. Let me see. While we looking at this text, we looking at this Kepar, right? Remember, that's the R. So you know it's a R, so you learning. So Keparu, Keparu, why? Because we see this bird here and we know that in this instance, this is possibly the Uchik. All right, Keparu, M. Now, you just gotta know Metal Nature for this and know every, look, y'all. Don't ever, the reason why I like making mistakes live is to let people feel more free to do it. No one is gonna ever try to participate with you when you make them feel a certain way about being incorrect. You feel me? And so that's one of some of the biggest mistakes. Like acting like you gotta be Mr. Perfect. And so anyway, this is gonna give us a car right here. Core, here go that R again, remember? And so I'm making the same style. Correct. Now, this text I'm looking at don't got nothing to do with the damn dictionary I'm about to go to. Like, they're not in cahoots with each other. I could pull up any other ancient Egyptian text and read words with R's in them and then go back with the dictionary and it's going to be consistent. I know I'm getting off the point a little bit, but I'm addressing how people say this stuff ain't deciphered. It's just stupid. And so we showed the Syria was there. We have to address this logogrammic R. And like my brother Asar pointed out, if their parsing of these sentences is correct, because if I go all the way over here, see, this is another thing. Every time I decode what they doing wrong, I see something that's in the real world. And that's why you can't really mess with me. It's like, I don't know what it is. For instance, I'm questioning these R's right here with the stroke under them, correct? I have a theory that they're messing up for pronouncing this as a part of a word that supposedly is supposed to say Israel. Now watch how this works. This is scientific. If, because this stele was written by one person, correct? Maybe a couple of artisans or scribes. Who knows? But the grammar of it is consistent with the time period, meaning that this ain't holding the place of no damn L at the end. This is his own word, and let me prove it with another term over here, right on the same line. You see that single stroke? You see that R in front of a throw stick and some mountains? Now you see a single stroke and an R in front of a throw stick and some people. So let's just be clear on what we see. It's in the final position of each term. It's not even supposed to be attached to the term. And let me show you why. Because they being pseudo and they think we'll never get this smart. And now I know they watching because of that video I seen from dude talking about the Kemet. So now let me just be prouder putting out this information. This is pseudo. And I'm going to challenge anybody to go through some real text and show me the relevance in ancient times of a place called Gezer. You can read the wiki. Why am I saying this? Because we're supposedly reading a stela of a man who took trips through a place and was beefing and beating up the people he had funk with. And Gezer gets mentioned? How that fit? Well, let me talk about it. First, we know this is a link to the trading routes of Syria. And it's actually on what they would call the coast of Syria. If you don't understand, all of Israel is really just the coast of Syria, then you got to do something about looking at geography. All right? But Gezer is pseudo, and I'm going to tell you why. I'm not going to just do rhetoric. I always like to demonstrate. You see how far we in? They got this little pseudo R at here, right here. It's fine for it being there, but they're forcing it here. They say that this term is Gezer. Okay, now let's follow my logic. I say this is a different word, which would take this off of that. First of all, they're taking two A's and making them E's. See, this is cheating. Let me show you why. Because you have to understand this. The only time we inject E's is between consonants that don't have vowels between them. It's called Egyptology speak. It's not a real thing. But what they're doing here is telling us that this location is Gezer. Now I'm going to show you what I mean. I'm going to go down here and let's go. But notice this. They don't even want to do it like they do. They don't even want to put up no metal netter on it for the wiki. Like, they'll go back there a lot of the times. They don't want to do it. But when I go to Gaza, they're going to do it. Why is they going to do it? Let me see. For Gaza. Because the word is Gaza, not Gezer. The R shouldn't be there. Nope, they didn't for Gaza, too. So let's keep it. At least let them get their credit for stopping there, even though they know this term. Go back to the Medu Netra. As I'm proving, and I'm going to continue to prove with their pseudo transliterations of Gezer. So let me show you this. We're questioning this R, and it's making perfect sense. You take this R as its own word. You have what they have as a Q here. This Q is giving us a G. This is an A. We went over that a long time ago. It should never be represented as an E, and I don't know where they do that at. This is giving us the J, DJ sound, which is transliterated as a Z in that instance. I can show you and prove it. I know from the Magi, I got this DJ, and when they put Mazui, They talking about the Magi. And this is an A. See, another bird. Even though it don't got a beak, some could say it might be an M bird because it don't got a beak. Nevertheless, it'll be a U-chick or whatever, or an M bird. But they say it's an E because this is supposed to transliterate to Gazir. So if you do the knowledge, you got G-A-Z-A, Gaza. But you think I'm making that up? All right, I got to show you. First of all, I don't think they got Gaza in here like that. All right, but I bet you they got Gazir in here, so I can show you that. And that's going to be to make it all right. But if they don't got Gazir, I probably need to find it in a primary on the TLI. Yeah, because that Gazir stuff is fake. You feel me? And so let me go to the TLI. When you see Gazir, you're going to see exactly what I mean. Right? It's going to be using the DJ sound for a Z. I'm going to take that out. Maybe turn this off. All right, well, I got to find Gazir. I don't feel like going too far finding Gazir, but I will. Y'all know I looked over that before. So what we got? I know how I can translate. I can show you. Just go to Lichium's translation. I'll go to the Marin Patastel in the TLA. Come on, son. So how you find that in the TLA is one term I know, S, capital S, R, M, capital A, maybe. If this term pops up in the TLA, it's going to take me to the Marin Patastel. Hold up. So take the A off of it. All right, here we go. Peace, shalom. See, now this was only used one time, and what was that? The Mara Patastel. So that's how I know it's gonna take me there. Bob, why they got this in the satirical letter of Anastasia, bruh? This is wonderful. So this is another place where they use the so-called term for shalom. Like, this is exciting to me, because I thought the only thing it was about to pull up was the Mara Patastel. So now I gotta go back and find it, because they got another attestation for that. To lay down, oh, let me tell you why. See, this gets more, damn, the knowledge don't ever stop. You wanna know why that was? Because these people on the top attestation are saying peace as a greeting. But the Hebrews supposedly, whoever, I don't want to miss due time anachronistically, whoever that was supposedly speaking on the Marin Patastella, they was laying down their arms. They was seeking peace. You see the difference? Remember I wrote an article, it was called When Shalom Was Only Stated by the Cowering Man? Bro, that was not an insult. To lay down arms. Now we say that right now in the hood. You just don't say two, and you don't say arms. You say lay down or get down. It's still the same thing. When you getting robbed, lay down. You think I'm messing that up? To lay down arms. I'll tell you the terms for this, actually, obeisance or differentiated respect. When one person, they both playing respect, but it ain't equal. This is stall me out. In the hood in Oakland, they said stall me out. They said shalom, or seek peace. And so now when I click on this attestation, this damn show gonna take me to the Mara Patastel if they got the Mara Patastel in here. You feel me? So where did they take me to? Some chariot hymn? They got on their knees saying they would ask you for peace because of your power. So this is gonna be the same attestation, but they calling it the chariot hymn. If not, then damn, this is good too. Let me see. But from what I know, this is going to have to be related to Marin Patah. It don't have to be. See, it wreaks havoc in Lebanon. Okay, we about to see what else they talking about. Nah. So they got two attestations, it seems, for the use of Shalom, but I didn't see it in here that were not from the Marin Patah Stela, and I still ain't found it. I'm just getting lost now. I just learned two good things by putting this term in here. But the term I'm using is Shalom. So maybe I shouldn't play myself like that. I should use Israel. The Shalom is found in, as we see, Shalom, Sharma, a long word, is found in two different attestations. And now we know three. The other one is the Mer and Patah Stel. And Patah, not Ta. I don't care what y'all say. It's not Greek. Lay down the bow. Sharma Pejit, who did this? And the Victory Stela of Paiyi. Interesting. 26th Dynasty, so that works. Well, we chilling. I don't want to get you lost. Let's get you back to it. What I was just looking over was this term right here, but every attestation of it ain't leading me back to the Marin Patah Stela. If I put this right here, nothing better not pop up in the TLA. So that lets you know. I'm going to put Israel. What we eating? Everybody DoorDash right now. Come on. Different cities. I think I'm going to get a clam chowder bowl. But one thing about that, though, when I order that, you know what? I bought some clam chowder and said, I'm going to stop paying them so much for them damn clam chowder bowls. Feel me? I'm going to just go buy their bread. I'm going to go buy their bread bowl. And then do it that way. How y'all like that? Knowing what I'm eating in the middle of what we study. I put Israel in the TLA. I'm such a goofy. I should have put this a long time ago. Because it's only a... Oh, see? They don't even want to mess with this. This word, there is no text corpus attestations. So that just means that Israel ain't... the Marin Patah Stel. Now, you see, this is what I'm talking about. When I just did my transliteration, what is Yizirr? I don't know what Yizirr is, but stop playing with me. Hotep, now what is this supposed to be about Israel? A Israeli cat snake? Come on, man, you making stuff up with that question mark. So how far off did I go? Oh, I'm still having convinced the people who say he's stupid. Syria wasn't called Syria in those times. So let me get in on them people who don't do enough research. So first of all, it was. All right, let me go back to what I'm bringing to the community and everybody, and you won't find it taught nowhere before the dates on my videos. It can be proven as my intellectual property. It don't matter what platform you put it into. Do you understand copyright? Ain't nobody on this earth said this says Syria out their mouth in no tangible form and put it in no tangible form. So we have timestamps. You know what's bigger than any contract you ever sign? Believe it or not, material evidence. Reggie will break y'all all down with this. He'll show y'all how them courts really work. You can have any type of paper saying that you own something. If it's material evidence that you don't, what you think the judge gonna go with? I'm just going off on a tangent, but we need to know how that works. And so we got S-Y-R-I-A. Some people tell me that you're anachronistic. this isn't happening in this time period, so let's do the homework. What time period is it not happening in? Let's go back to Mer and Ptah Stele. So you're arguing that Syria was not called Syria at about 1208 BC. Let's keep this chronology right. That's what the argument against my finding is. So then let's go look at some stuff. Well, I don't want to flam bam. I already got the homework. I was just about to, you know, just go do it all on Google. But why do that? I'm just going to take y'all to that work. But let me see. Sometimes I don't title my documents, and sometimes I'll be having business documents. So I'll be like, hold on. I mean, ain't nothing, you know, nothing like that. But Oh, I could type. Maybe if, there we go. Dang. I just typed Syria in my finder and it took me to the document. For some reason, I couldn't find this document. And the origins of the term Syria, hold on. So this is what you putting, getting hands put on by. Siri yo-yo? See, that's what you're dealing. You're going to have to deal with these people. Called the Siri yo-yo. But I don't even want to have to beat people up like this, man. Start just falling back. If you don't got the time to be doing that research like that, don't hit me with what you already know. Because the majority of stuff I'm going to be talking about is something you don't already know about. So when you say the Greeks said this, I'm going to be like, dog. Why my level is that low to you in your brain that you think I ain't addressed what the Greeks called Syria before I got on a public platform talking about some crazy stuff? That's disrespect. The origin of the term Syrian, you see how they got an N in parentheses, right? See, this N in parentheses, if you really want to know, is represented on the Stella. You just got to know how to read it. Now, I'm not saying linguistically. When you take Syria, you got a place. When you put an N on the end, you got people of that place. Now, let's go back to the Stella. It says Syria with people on the end, which is represented phonetically as a ooh sometimes. Plurality. Syria. And I'm leaving out this word because we got to figure that out. Syria, re-u. But let's continue. We were showing how Gaza had came to that, but I don't want to, I'm going to get into that. I just forgot and closed that page out. And so I don't want to be all over the place. I'm going to get back to this good document. And I ain't going to read it for you, but you see the title of it. And then I'm going to give you another source on this because I don't want people to be stuck on one document. You never do that. But Johnny Meso gave you enough to just tell people to fall back, bro. So we was doing that 1208 when they made that Stella. Since the 19th century, a number of scholars have put forth various theories about the etymology of the basically Greek term Syrian and its Aramaic counterpart Syrioi or Syrioyo, because this isn't Syrioi. We're going to talk about that in a minute. So this is Syrioyo, Aramaic. For a proper understanding of this history of these of this illustration or illustrious names in the two different languages, it will prove useful to analyze their background separate from one another. First, I'll discuss the most persuasive theory as regards to the origin of the word Syria and or Syrian too. And secondly, two hypotheses on the Aramaic term Syrioyo will be examined in the final part of this paper. New contextual backdrop and the shark will be sharply demarcated. Backdrop and sharply demarcated period would be proposed that helps us to understand the introduction of this name into the Aramaic language. So I'm not going to even read it. I'm going to skim over it. I'm going to provide it for y'all to read it. I read it before, and I'm going to get to the points that he needs to make. Either this document or the other document details the linguistic phenomenon that, here it goes right here. They detail the linguistic phenomenon that the Greeks went through in leaving the A off of the people known as the Assyrians. See? So here it goes right here. Now, they're going to start breaking it down. It says it contains the bilingual text written in Luwian hieroglyphs and the Phoenician alphabet. So we're going to get to how the Greeks came to that, but we are closer to the source because somebody thought 1200 BC was antiquitous or something. I mean, it's ancient. Don't give me, it is antiquitous. It is, that's antiquity. But it was Greeks, everybody running around. So in this Luwianese hieroglyphs and Phoenician alphabet, we have terms, toponyms. In Phoenician, the toponym Assyria and the Gentilic Assyrians are spelled, now they got that little diphthong, so something represents that A vowel there. See? So Shir and Shireen. So in that Semitic language, you know these are a people because they put the yim at the end. Ashirim and Ashir. Possibly translated Ashir and Ashirim. Yep. And so not Ashur and Ashurim. I don't know. It says while its Luwian counterpart. Now look, this is what beat you up. Not you, but them. What was the Luwianese counterpart? Damn, man. Huh? What is Luwian hieroglyphs? Dang, bruh. I be having to show people. While its Luwian counterpart has Sura'i. What I want to point to here is we have an A and an I at the end of what the Luwianese people called those people. Now, they have a slash here. You understand why the slash is there. Because these weak vowels used in ancient languages, they is like, was it an A or an I at the end? The same thing that is represented when we look at the Stela. An I and an A. S-Y-R-I-A. Now, how is that far from the ancient Luwianese term, Luwian term, S-U-R-A-I, R-S-U-R-A, or S-U-R-I? How is the Luwian hieroglyphs connected to these people? Bruh. Don't even be talking about it then. Do you know where this is? I hope she read the whole thing.
Luwian.
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 So where is the Luwian language spoke? And there you got it. There go your cow. So they giving everything up. Where was it spoke? Luwianese. So this is where we get our Luka people from. Now they're going to say here the hieroglyphic Luwian is found in the higher areas of Anatolia, which is Syria. Western Syria. Let's see. Ancient language and group of language within the Anatolian branch. You know what Anatolian is? That's what they're talking about. So let's see. Of the two variants of the Proto-Luwian and Luwian in a narrow sense, as known after inscriptions in which they were written, cuneiform Luwian and the hieroglyphic Luwian. Now that's what we're talking about. All right. Hieroglyphic Luwian. Let's look at the... So they say extant around 600 BC. We got that going back further than that. But just to be safe, we're going to look at the attestation, and we like to... Oh, it say extinct. I was about to say. I was like, they tripping. It was extinct around 600 BC. I thought it said extant. You see? But like I was just saying before that, it date back way longer than that. Second millennium. 14th century, the earliest hieroglyphs appear on royal seals dating from the second millennium C, but only from the 14th century BC. Okay, so we beat the date of 1200 BC. See? Damn, man. I need to go someplace with this. Somebody like the video. More people deserve to see this. You know, shout out to all my supporters. Shout out to the good guy, I see you. And shout out to the members of the channel who's helping to push it along. And everybody who helping. Just because you ain't a member don't mean you ain't helping. But I see they made an effort to let it be known. And I appreciate that. You know what I'm saying? And so, let's keep it going. So now in this hieroglyphics, Luwian, or Luwian, yeah. We got what? What do we have? We have a term given to us that matches the Israel Stella. That ain't gonna be called the Israel Stella. It's gonna be called the Syria Stella. Because people can see now. So let's keep going. So now watch some European video pop on YouTube in about 6 months. Oh, new findings. Trust me. You know why? Because ain't nobody gonna take this from me, but they gonna take the information from me. But they won't, you feel me? They won't accept it coming from me, but they'll take the information and repackage it and deliver it. And take it to academia, and that's fine. I know I could write this up and really beat them up and go get my honorary PhD. Say I can't. This is gonna be right. So look, the Luwian counterpart has Syria to cover both forms. I didn't even wanna keep reading to beat y'all all the way up. What does that mean? It has this to cover both forms of Asher and Asherim. It was not uncommon in antiquity to employ a geographical name in the singular as a collective, denoting a group of people like Kemet. See? So, I mean, being that, but I don't even need to show y'all the other document. Because just this work right here is putting handlebars. This is scholarly work. The sources is here. In 2006, Rollinger brought to the attention a recent published inscription dated to the second half of the 8th century BC from a Turkish town called Sinikoy. Or Sinikoy, yeah. Okay. In the inversions of Adama. And if you want the source, he put it right there. Books that don't got footnotes, I mean, it's levels to this. When you got a source that make a claim and don't give no effort to show how they're backing up their claim, it's not really a credible source. You can take it as such, But it let people know the level of what you're willing to accept as scholarship. Meaning someone can just tell you something. Scholars put what's called footnotes. And if we, and if us as students ain't learned how to never pass up that number, if you if you're not interested in what they're saying in that sentence, then pass up that number at the end. But if you think you did the knowledge on something and you don't know what's said at that number right there, you're tripping. So the majority of scholars, and it depends on what type of format they're using, they might put it at the bottom of the page you actually reading. So it's saying here, R. Rollinger, Asirioe, see? And Luke Asirioe. And now, the funny part about it is I'm about to go read that. Because I ain't read that yet. I read this other one. All right? But I ain't read this one. And so the funny part is he's saying the same thing. Asirioe, Sirioe, Sirios, and Luca Sirioes. So if you understand what Luca, S-L-U-K-K-A. So this is why I want to just keep making people understand what I see when I see it. I'm going back to an ancient Egyptian dictionary. L-U-K-K-A. Dang, why they do me like that? They supposed to know Luca. So what, did I spell it wrong? Do I got it on case? Let me take it off case sensitive. Well, I know they know it, but I might have to show y'all with the TLA. If the dictionary ain't hip enough, maybe the TLA might be. But Luca is basically just an area in Anatolia where they lived. Let's try translations. Let's see if we can find any primary text talking about Luca. They don't want to mention Luca. Let's see this with this button. So I could probably remember, but I'm going to leave that out. We'll pull that up because when I can't find no source, I can't talk about nothing. So that's the best type of show, right? Shut up when you can't find no source. Then you won't be in no trouble. So here we go back. Well, anyway, I'm tripping. I could tell you this. It just wasn't in the ancient Egyptian dictionary. I could just put it right here. L-U-K-K-A. You're going to see Luca Anatolia. See right here? And you see it was purple because I already been through this. The Luca lands. And so this is exactly what I was just showing us 10 minutes ago when I was showing us where the certain part of the map was. So look, we was talking about the Nubians of Ugarit. In my last video, I just need people to understand this. Here go you, Garita. And I just showed, now this make me hella mad that they actually call this damn area Nahesi in their language, but ain't nobody mess with that yet. Cause don't nobody do this language. You see what I'm showing y'all though? I got a letter from the Pharaoh of Egypt to Ugarit, right? To the Nahesu. I'm not good at cognates, but I know one thing. We got the N, the H, and the S. And we got another S after that. I don't know nothing about this place. It's just weird to me that I got a letter, which is a primary account from the temple of Amun, writing to the Nubians of, not in, the Nubians of Ugarit, all right? And then you come right here and you clearly see it say in Lu, see this language that we're looking at. I'm assuming this is a Hittite. I'm assuming this is the language I've just been investigating. Luwian. Right? If this wind up being Nahesi and Luwian, it's going to be over. What is Nahusa? Don't say nothing about no snake, bro. This is not no Hebrew. Somebody talking about it. I ain't gonna go get on no Google Scholar or nothing, no, none of that. Anyway, that was just interesting to me to see that, but that's not why I came here. I came to show the area of Luca, all right? So when they say the Luca, you see it say Luca here? So when they say the Luca Sirioi kind of was at the borders of, they wasn't all, this is Hattie, we're in the Hittite land now. But over here, where Mitanni is, just knock that out and call this Syria. Not Assyria, but again, we've seen that the people didn't determine between the two. Assyria is between the Tigris and the Euphrates at the top. That's not what we're talking about. But again, these people didn't make no distinctions in their writings. So what we see Mitanni here and a little bit higher, we probably call that some Syria area. So when we say that the Levant and stuff is the coast of Syria, all you got to do is pull up another map and look right at it. If I type Syria, but you can't be thinking they might show us modern borders. Don't be fooled by the modern borders. But look, you see, it's the same exact thing, even close with the modern borders. You see what I'm saying? So what we just looking, look, Ugaritic would be right over here. Ugarit would be right over here. This is like the Luca, or these are the Luca Syrioi who lived over here. That's the Luca Syrioi. But the regular Syrioi and the Syrioyo lived in Syria. Now, don't confuse that with, I can't see the Tigris and Euphrates on here. But someplace over here, the Tigris and Euphrates, that's the Assyrian Empire. A little bit over more, you feel me? But they turned into one, as the scientists and scholars teach us. Still didn't order my vids yet. Because I pulled out on that plan. Let me see. I kind of want to wait for my counterpart so we can go treat her to something. Let me see. So, yeah, I was just in his footnotes, and I went too far about, but you see the world, the information you get from looking at the footnotes. So it contains a lingual text written in Luwian hieroglyphs and Phoenician alphabet, and we went over all of that. And how Rollinger concluded, he says, the Greeks established closer contacts with the southern Anatolia and northern Syria, where Cilicia area, where the Luwian statue was found, and also played a crucial role. So rather than having corrupted Syria from Assyrian in Greek, the Greeks may have well adopted the short form of these regions. So what that mean? That mean, oh, I appreciate that, Queen Setep and Ra. All right. All right, it says, this was perhaps from the Luwian. Yeah, I am going to do it. I am going to write this all up into something and blah, blah, blah. But I just was talking about why I'm not really tripping off of, you know, sharing the information. Who knows? Others could probably take it further than me. I've never been that. I don't think information is like that. I don't own the fact that it says Syria on there. And it might be disproven. But I'm showing the holes in my argument, and I'm showing the ways that you need to attack it. Like that Winnie word only had 5 attestations. That doesn't discredit it to me, because Israel only has 1 attestation, supposedly. And we roll strong with that. But anyway, in this document, he's basically breaking down the myth and the notion that Syria was not called Syria in those time periods. All right, and so he makes another good point, and I don't want it to be left out. So I'm gonna try to scroll down. So Syria was called Syria. We using Egyptian grammar, we can reparse the Israel Stel, and we just still got two anomalies, these final R's. And that's not a big one. You could turn that one over to scholars and say, you figure that part out. But it's consistent. It's not inconsistent. You take that R off of Gazir, you got Gaza. And you can't argue that Gazir was as significant as Gaza in ancient times. Is there a native tongue where they're always clear in distinction? I still was trying to look for one more statement he made in here. So he's showing you all of, they're going through the linguistics. But I think it must have been the other document that's teaching the phenomenon that it says, because of history, because the history of the Syrians had to be Assyrianized, one way to achieve this goal, besides changing their name from Sir Yahya to Atariya, or whatever, was to render Sir Yahya and reprints it with the initial elf, although to provide the, see, this is the type of stuff you have to read the whole thing, which I have, but I'm talking about for y'all to get it. Let me see. And so I think we made a clear point just with this one document, but this is not the other, this is not the one that I want you to see. There's still one more. Yeah. So there you have it. The origin of the term Syria and Syrioi once again. So I think the first document is called The Origin of the Names of Syria and Syrioi. And then this is the second one called Once Again. People pretty much can read the whole entire document by watching me scroll through it and just stopping their screen and reading what they want to read. If you're in some remote location where you can't. All right, so now, I mean, we knocked that down. Don't be always, man, the problem is whenever we say the Greek started something, that came from the Greek. Man, cut that out. I heard somebody make an erroneous claim or agree to an erroneous claim that there might not be no Greek script and it might have came from the Coptic. Man, I was like, man, I'm not even going to say nothing. That's such a pseudo claim. All of this stuff that people was acting like that you sat in the hoods, the ghettos of America and figured out. Stop tripping, bruh. That includes me. Like, as soon as we prove that this ain't right, then throw me right back in there. And I'm not taking, no, don't, bruh. See, y'all want to take the harshness of the reality and misuse it and act like I'm not acting like there ain't no geniuses in the hood. Don't do that to yourself, because you know that's not what I'm saying. I'm simply saying, you trying to act like everybody hop on, man, come on, dude. You don't see the fix is in. There's a new fascination. Now you don't want to be Kobe Bryant. Now you don't want to be, now you want to be like a cult leader. These people who never be wrong, everything they say is right. They know everything and they better than the world because they beat every brain that's been thinking on things in academia. They be like, nope. I'm the one. Now, again, you can compare that to any of the claims that I made today. Ain't nothing that I showed you standing on my own perception. You see what I mean? None of this could be called my personal erroneous assessment or dubious analysis. Because I'm showing you by qualified sources every step of the way in demonstrating what I think. I'm not just giving you that rhetoric. And so I didn't look for the second thing I was looking for in this document, but it is a very good one when concerning these matters. So then the work that needs to be done, I mean, my personal agenda for this project, as far as this rendering of Damar Patel, still. The work that needs to be done for me is not proving that people called the area Syria in those time periods. Most people who are scholars of the area will already know what primaries to refer to prove that. And next, the overwhelming evidence that weigh in on the behalf of my assertion is that you got this word right here, Koru, for a land, which means the land of Syria. You can't make that up. There's no way in the world you can magically metal nature that. You trying to tell me that it say some people right here. See the people? It spell out Syria. We just went over the scholarly text that showed that Syria was used as a name for a people. And then we got what they call their land right here, Koru. All right, Koru. You take Koru and pop that. X-R-W, you pop that in a dictionary, it's going to give you Syria. All right? It's going to give you Syria. You just have to look at all these other renditions. Let me see. Should I use the smaller X? How about doing it the easier way? S-Y-R-I-A. You're going to take you to Koru. I'm just going backwards because Koru had 100. See? Core. See that core? Now, here go the Ru on it. So don't act like I'm not finding nothing. Core, you think that's not on there? You see that? You see the bird? You see the lion and the single stroke? Let's go back to the Stella. So why is Syria right next to damn Syria on the damn Syrian Stella? All right. Now this say Koru, what they call Syrians. I bet you we ain't gonna find no attestation for that. But whatever. Here it is, Koru. All right, the Ru is in the name of the lion. Since they put a single stroke, we say Ru. So that one works, that single stroke, but it's not over an R, it's over under a Ru. Oh, Dash Arab, thanks for becoming a supporter, much appreciated. You know what I'm saying? Now you're gonna get all the Magi manuals. You're gonna even be the first, the Sherb Magi, you feel me? Shout out. I appreciate that. So, I mean, in closing of this video, since I didn't order no vits, because I started thinking about the extra money that DoorDash is going to charge me, I'm going to go sit down in a restaurant and probably watch something. In closing, let's start from where we should have started. Because you don't just read. Any of y'all do this, this ain't magic. It don't require special people. If you go to Egyptology class at the end of it, if you are reading, if they focus on the grammar, you're going to know how to read it at the end. And so don't let nobody be acting like they better than you or nothing. Let me see. But I don't know if I got the first beginning of this over here. All right. So right here we got something that's telling us to walk or to come. If y'all can see, I'm on the second row. Could start from the top, but this is kind of cut off. So let's do it the right way. We could do it the right way. We was just on Wiki. I'm getting hungry though. About to be up out of here. Let me see. And I mean, we are. One day we started from the top. One day we started from the top, and I was like, yo, this video gonna be 200 hours because the text that we need to get to is all the way down at line 27 to talk about Israel. And so let's look at the parsing of this and see if we can find a good point to start to try to read it. All the pseudo demonstrators, they be scared to make a mistake in person. If you make a mistake, I make mistakes when reading English. Y'all hear it. So why would I care? Making a mistake is part of it. But you got to display you could do it, though. You feel me? That's what I'm saying. Like, you can't say you could ride a bike and every time you get on the bike, you fall flat on your butt and you never, ever, ever could pedal three pedals. I know that wasn't the best analogy. I'm starting over here. Yeah, because I just say N. It got an N at the bottom, so I'm still shouldn't be starting right there. It says Shaul something. I don't know, whatever. I'm damn near about to just do the line we was on. So we got this new or any N. You could just say any, and I think this N is part of the any, so I think this is any. So this is a location. We see this here, and you know this location. I remember what this is supposed to hold the place of? Like an E sound. S, ish. This is a Q, A. Now, this is weird here. Because it appears to be a D or the hand D, but it's written a little different. It might be something else. This is an N and a Y. So what is this? Location. Okay. Yeah, this is Ashkelon. And so this is why this N is right here. And they just put an E at the end. But apparently this is like going to or something about any ooh, I don't know why they got a D there, but Ni, Ashkelani, I think this is going to be Ashkelon. I know the text, but I don't got it memorized. I know the locations that should appear on the text, and this one I'm attributing to Ashkelon right now. So then we got the throw stick and the land to let us know is a thing. Now we got Mayu, or May. May is to, you know, that's a whip. To May is to whip somebody, but I don't know how they're using it here. We can look it up, but it's going to make the ending of this video take hella long. So anybody could watch, slow down, and say, you was wrong, go, nah. No, I'm not. Punk, watch this. M-H. Show me, I'm a God dang, it just popped right up in your face. So stop sleeping on your brother. Let's go. May. All right? Do that, May. But don't get it confused because it's hella maze. I said it was a whip. I know the context of this text. And it still could be wrong that it's not a whip right there. So what? But I'm saying it's a whip right now, like this May. To hold, to seize, to lay hands of, to lay hold of, to grasp, to capture. See? That's the May they're using there. And so if you want to go back, you see it right here. How I know? Because they got their hand right at the bottom. May was at the top. You see this whip? May. Ooh. May, ooh. So they're capturing. Ashkelon could be captured now, right? How you know they're talking about Ashkelon? Well, it says go to capture Ashkelon. Now, you could go read their translations and see if it matches up at least closely to what I'm saying. Let's get back down to where we was at. This is it, huh? Capture Ashkelon, May, M. Now, here go Gaza. So this is why I keep on saying, take this R off the end. This ain't Gazir. If I go look at the distance, well, Gazir and Gaza are still close to each other, but the historical significance of a place called Gazir is strictly biblical, yo. There's not no body tripping off no Gazir in Egypt. It was just a little spot. And so why would they be talking about smashing big Ashkelon and then they got this area for Gazir? They didn't put a Niut sign like they did over here for Ty Mary. So in they schemata, Gaza or Gazir is more spacious than Ty Mary. This represents like a town. This more or less represents like a county. I mean, for the way you want to say it. You know, people could say that's kind of correct. And so why they using the bigger area for a little ass Gazir? But anyway, this is Gaza. M. Gaza or Gazir? I'm just going to tell you what the scholars say. So M. Gazir, all right. Now we got another location because we got that Gazir. This is the R ender right here. You got the throw stick and the land. So you know that's done. Now you got Yim. But this Shepesh, though, messed me up. But you're supposed to skip that. So you got Yim. You got Yin Nu. Yenamam. So let's spell that. You go Yen-O-A-M. Come on, dude. I need to eat good today. Take care of your boy. Let me see. Yenamam. Okay. See? Yenamam. See, so we on the text, and we just read Yinoam right here. It's just a little different form of what the dictionary showed us, or wiki showed us. Yinoam, so that's a place. Now it says M. Oh, that's the last M in Yinoam, a phonetic complement. Now we got to the part that we went over, Uriu. Well, if this is a chick bird, this is Uriu. That is making something happen. When you see that eye, it is the eye of a creator. I don't want to go pseudo. It means to make, but it is the eye of a creator. Want me to prove it? Just put an I and an R in the dictionary. You're going to see all of this stuff. When it has the I in it, it's going to reference, see, creator. Golly. Nothing I do ain't qualified, because the only point of reference I got is my studies. I'm not coming from no point of reference with I got a pseudo menudo who taught me something and he was my master teacher and I gotta now adhere to that. So when you see the eye, it's like a creator, but you don't want to think of it like theophorically or theologically. It's like a person who could really manufacture things in reality. See, a doer is what they called it right here. Not like no mythological stuff. Look, they made it better. A maker of things. So now let's go back. You see that eye? I said it's a creator. It's a maker. It's going to cause something here. It is Iriu M. Tim. Now, if you know what Tim mean, and Tim right here, we need to talk about Tim. Because it say Iriu M. Tim. This one I would have to go refer to the Seshu. They do the grammar and they'll give me their assessment on what they think. How it's probably some Seshu in the building. So what I mean by Iriu M. Tim, the grammar of that structure, make, the verb is first. Now we got the conjunction M. Okay. Now we got Tim. Tim could either be a noun. Wait, verb, make, to, it gotta be, what could it be if it got a verb, a subject, object? It could be the object or the subject. And if this was used to exist, how do you use to exist? Normally it's placed in front of a sentence like this. But like, what is existence? A person, place, a thing, a noun is a noun, huh? It's an adjective here. So it is in an adjectival position. What I mean is, let me show y'all. Tim in the dictionary is going to give us two options. One of them, I mean, it'll give us more than two options. You could get atum. You can get a lot of things from that. But in this context, we got to know what we're looking at. So I'm going to put a T and an M. And a lot of these, so look, see, right here is already there. Notice how we got to a Tim and it got, oh, this is it. This is the whole sentence. Dang, this be crazy. Bruh, this is the whole, I don't know if I got meta natter magic. Y'all ain't got it like me. I mean, fuck it. How the whole sentence pop up like this? I just put a T and an M. But you see, everything we scrutinized and just popped up. That I that I said to make. Now we got this M. You just got another M on the Stela. Let me show you. This is a M, but on the Stela, we got another version of the M. And so let's go back. See that I, the chick bird, but no, that's not the M bird because it got a beak. So this is ooh. Now this is the other version of the M. Now here go to Tim. And that's a phonetic complement for the final M on the word Tim, right? It looks just like that M above it, see? And that's an M over here because we said Yohanam, see? This shit is consistent. Don't let no, excuse my language, don't let no pseudos fool you. They have to come show you how it's inconsistent. So we got, this is a whole phrase here. This is very interesting that they have this entered as a phrase now, because this also affects my research. If this is a phrase and they say they have this in more than one place, I need to see it. Because what I think is they doing the European fortification of Israel, right? By taking this term, by taking this phrase and placing it in a dictionary. But from the one attestation that I'm reading right now. So you can't define something from something. Like you, that's like defining a word with a word. We already know you can't do that. You see what I mean? If this is the only attestation of this phrase or this verbiage, then you can define it by breaking it down. Because this is make right here. And this is M, like a conjunction. Now right here is either, this is the negation. So now I just learned something else in this sentence, Asar. Because right here, the negation they got as Tim. But notice when we look at the Stella, the negation is written ni over the word uni. Nevertheless, before we go over to see what they said, it said it means to destroy, right? It means to cause not to exist. To destroy something or someone. It actually is like to make not exist. But I was only looking for this Tim right here. So let's continue. But it was just weird that the whole entire phrase that we are scrutinizing popped up on my first. This is how I know the computers have consciousness and stuff, man. I believe in that. Call it pseudo or whatever. Ain't no way that could be happening. But anyway, let's keep going. Let me see. I'm trying to get to the 10 we dealing with. So this is an option. All and everything, entirety. Remember that. This is an option. Negates the sentence. These are your two options. Trust me, I don't want to take you through every 10. Atum ain't an option. He ain't no deity behind this Tim. These other Tims ain't an option. These Tims are the options. It either means all or everything entire, or it's negating the sentence. Let's go back to the Tim. It's right here. Make by either all. So notice this. This is peculiar. I think this means all and every. And not negating the senses because we got ni right here. So it makes make them all not exist. Cause them all to not exist. Uriu, M, Tim, ni, win. Now I'm reading, I told you I was going to read it the scholastic way and not give you my conjecture. But you know what I think. And so they say this is Israel, which is yes, year. R, okay, and then we got Feket. We read this often, so y'all could almost memorize this by now. Feket, and then you can memorize this, and you could go to where this is stored at that museum, and read that line over and over for the different people who keep walking through the museum, and get you money put into your hoopty can. No disrespect to can collectors. Feket. Ben Peret F. Feket. All right, we're gonna walk it slow. Walk it slow. I ain't gonna tell you what none of these words mean. You can translate it for your damn self. Watch this. You know what? Man, they better stop playing with me. I hate when I put terms in here. Oh, maybe I should put a capital X. This is not no wig, and I don't want to mislead y'all. It's not a dissolution. I need to put a capital X. F capital X T. All right, take the T off. Because I need y'all to come with the translation and make the X lowercase. Dang, profoundly. So we're going to find it. Here we go. To slay, to destroy, to be neglectful. But what? Hold on. You only got feck. It ain't feminized. So let's go over here and see why feckette is feminized. Because feckette been per et. We got to understand the grammar. The verb or whatever is going to be feminized because what? Because the noun it's addressing is feminized. And adjectives will be feminized that way too. So if it's a feminine noun, which is, well, seed, right? Perret. Well, this needs to match the gender, the verb too, not in all cases, but the action committed on something of a gender will match that gender as well. And again, somebody could say, no, that is grammatically incorrect. Well, nevertheless, we see feck is the word, but it's feminized here for cat. And then it has a determinative for bad under it. And so when we go back to the dictionary, we see feck is to slay, destroy. Now, let's see if we can find it with the T. So that let us know that since it don't have a rendition with the T, there goes one with the T, it don't mean that. So that let us know that that is a feminized term here. Feck. Feckette means to. Now, when we say feckette bin, I'm not going to do none of the defining because that's pseudo menudo. I just know how to read it so I could transliterate it for you. All right. So feckette bin. Bin is what? Not. Now, do I got to take you further than that? There are other bins, but since I'm guiding this, this is the correct bin. All right. So you got feckette bin. Remember, it was to slay. After they say Israel, they say feckette bin. Don't forget these things. Feckette was to slay or stuffing, and bin is not. Now we got peret. Now, perret is one of those words I possibly could find in the dictionary with its T on it, even though per is a word all in itself, because peret is a season. So that means peret exists as a feminine term all in itself as well. That is different from the feminized version of a house. A perti, a peret, pert imheru. That pert imheru ain't, see, it ain't pert imheruet. Well, I don't know. That would have messed it up. You wouldn't feminize the day, would you? Here we got peret for the winter seasons. It's good that we got peret here down here for people, but you got to have a people determinative. These is like homeboys. Broke it down on you because the house is... Why are they people and you got a house determinative and peret means to come out or to come forth? So they coming out the house, these your homeboys. You want to mess that up? Then take the people. But this is homeboys. Well, you know, boys and girls, but really it is related to a peret. It don't got nothing to do with the season. We'll continue so you can see what I mean. All right, peret, fruit, seed. So this is the peret we want for our discussion. Peret, fruit, or seed. And it's so funny, I had to, sorry, Reggie, my Magi, but we be in the danger room all the time. And I cut him with this in the danger room one time. Talking about ancient Egyptians thought that their baby was begotten whole or some old craziness. But I just used this one. I said, if they thought that, why do they put a phallus over a seed, which is the same word for fruit? Let's checkmate. Because they understand that there is seed inside of a phallus. That would mean they know that a seed has to grow. That mean they don't think that a baby was begotten whole. Come on now. See how easy that was with the metal nature? Tell the truth. Parat, yeah, emergence. So if you want the dictionary definition of what they're giving us, parat is departure, procession, desertion. All right? To come forth. So I was just slangizing it when I said homeboys. But the fact that they had those, they called them people in relation to the house. We need to keep the house in mind. So what happened here is parat was seed, right? So it says, Feket ben Peret, and now we got this F. F mean his. So we remember Peret was seed, and now we got an F, his seed. So what does it say about this? And the cold part is, why did they say his? Normally they would have said their. I'm just saying. Maybe, what is they saying about these other ones? Is they calling them he or she? Or is they saying they and them? They calling this a he. So he said, destroy, no seeds. He got no seeds. I mean, yeah, destroy, not. So this is the literal. I always do a literal before I do the translation. The literal says, first of all, we're going to read the transliteration. Faket ben Peretef. Just this part. Faket ben Peretef. Now, the literal is to destroy, not seed his. That's the literal. Now you got to make a translation out of the literal. And again, it literally says to destroy, not seed his. So scholars say his seed is not. Since you can leave this not out of it, because this is just negation. Ben is just negation. It lets you know you don't have to say the negation word. So you can say faket peret. You can say faket peretif. If you know it's negative, faket, this just destroy, peret is seed in his. Destroy his seed. His seed is destroyed because we got ben right here. So then we got, now I'm trying to finish this and get up out of here because I'm really hungry now. We got peru, keper, m, koret. Now this is when the wordplay comes in because kor is the Syria area, and Koret is a widow. So he's trying to rap. He's trying to be fly here. He's like, Karu, Kepakor, Koret. And you can even hear how it rolls off my mouth. That is bars. Karu, Kepar, U, M, Koret. Karu, Keparu, M, Koret. It sounds good, dude. It feel good. Why don't you try it one time? Say Karu, even though this might not be right. Who cares? It is. Karu, Keper, U, M, Koret. All right? And then I got an N, and that's going to finish to the next line. In what? And I'm not going to read the next line. In Ta Mary. In Ta Marie, Ta U, Neb, some more stuff. Now we could keep going forever. Thank y'all for tuning in. Thank y'all for tapping in. Thanks for let me look at my phone, see if I got anybody to celebrate with. Thank you. I don't got nobody to celebrate with, so let me see. I'm tripping. But thanks for everybody who contributed. I was trying to say something. I'm about to go grab me a bite and watch some Garfield TV or some something. Y'all, I ain't even got time for that final song. But in closing, I'll say, please keep, if you're interested in this, any of your contentions, I need to hear them because as I form a document, I mean, you know, again, before it's peer reviewed, it's kind of like peer reviewed by y'all. by people asking questions and poking holes and seeing how I will answer certain things. My biggest hole I thought before today was the fact that this Winnie that I propose it says was not used so often, but we find it used right in these time periods. And so I wouldn't be far-fetched to conject it, but it's not used on this text like this any other times. And I think that's going to be the hole in the whole theory right there. The fact that this needs to say Winnie, but others don't think so. Appreciate y'all. Thanks for tuning in, taping in. I'm about to go enjoy my day, take my dog for a walk and eat. All right.